This is home to the UK's largest exporter of loudspeakers. From here have come many of the great leaps forward in acoustic and electronic loudspeaker design over the past 25 years. Today, over 80% of the world's classical recordings are monitored on loudspeakers conceived in this sleepy Sussex town of Steyning. Within these doors, a project has been taking shape that draws on the past and combines it with radical new thinking to produce a loudspeaker that gets closer than any other to the sound of the original performance. The story begins with Laurence DIckie. Dick had long felt that the natural world held lessons for us in the pursuit of completely transparent sound reproduction. He and his colleagues at Steyning had already demonstrated that matrix cabinet construction, a rigid honeycomb structure, could deal with the problem of internal cabinet resonances. This time, not a honeycomb, but the humble garden snail provided the inspiration. Dick was sure the solution to the problem of sound coloration inside loudspeaker cabinets was contained in the unique natural curves of the snail's shell. Between this initial thought and the exponential transmission line Nautilus loudspeaker stood 3 years of painstaking research. The prize offered by this monitor is internal cabinet diffraction cut to below the level of audibility, matched with a negligible enclosure vibration decay time. Or, to put it another way, direct access to the heart of the music. The origins of Nautilus can be found in pioneering work done by our company founder, the late John Bowers, into the benefits offered by backless dipole sources. John could never accept the idea of loudspeaker drivers being boxed in. The DM70C was John's first response, with its curved bass chamber and 11-module electrostatic mid-range high-frequency unit shaped to disperse sound evenly. John experimented with variations on the electrostatic theme, coming closest to success with an arrangement of drivers mounted on an acoustically resistive baffle, larger at low frequencies to allow moving coil drivers to be used without extensive correction. Sadly, the completion of this work lingered just out of reach in a life filled with equally pressing priorities. Nearly 20 years later, Laurence DIckie returned to the dipole principle, believing it to be possible to create a hard baffle shaped to diffuse the acoustic boundary at the edge. The results were dramatic on the eye, if not the ear. This attempt successfully lost the contribution of the cabinet. Unfortunately, the composition of the driver cone became clearly discernible. The right answers, the wrong problem. The dipole wasn't the issue. What was needed was a solution to the reflections and resonances found in ordinary loudspeakers. The thinking became cylindrical, cardboard cylinders, and then plastic with polypropylene drive units mounted on them. Again, the plastic cone composition was audible. The driver itself would have to be put under the microscope. As this was B&W, no compromise was acceptable. A brand new 50mm aluminium dome mid-range driver was developed by Dick and the team. To overcome the sonic disadvantage of having a short magnet tube and the associated problem of constriction at the back of the moving coil magnet dome, Dick widened the hole in the magnet to its furthest extent. This indicated a need for a new, pear-shaped enclosure with a neck molded to fit the magnet like a glove. The broad cavity resonance was eliminated, but a new resonance of formidable Q had taken its place. The solution was one that John Bowers would have approved of, the lossy wave guide, or transmission line. Coupled with the new 50mm mid-range driver, the transmission line produced a response that even the most demanding studio engineer could smile about. The next challenge was to achieve adequate output at the lower frequencies. Four custom-made drivers were arranged in line inside a cylindrical enclosure and progressively rolled off to leave just one operating above 1 kHz. With a matrix 801 bottom end and a 75mm tweeter, the early signs were good. Measurements gave an impeccable on-axis response, but listening tests said otherwise. In transit to the 12-inch bass unit, the diffraction pattern changed dramatically, sounding as if something was wrong. Uneven angular dispersion was distorting the response, and so the four-driver cylinder was consigned to the B&W Museum of Might-Have-Beens. Dick sat down and rethought the idea. Inspiration struck. The solution was to lie in a cone and three-driver configuration with molded fins housing three drivers with their own transmission line pipes. No ordinary pipes, these were exponentially tapered to derive the benefit of a significant reduction in rear out-of-phase volume. Tests demonstrated that an exponential pipe with absorbent material mopped up more resonance than a cylindrical pipe. The taper reduces and compresses the damping wool as it gets more firmly packed at the end, removing all pipe resonance in the process. The curve of the taper is critical, as Dick demonstrates with his ripple tank.
In these demonstrations, the sound source is simulated by a vibrating point and the cabinet boundary by an aluminium strip. Here we see the waves smoothly following the curved boundary with no interference or standing waves. The attenuation provided by natural glosses here would be a result of the fibrous filling in practice. The result in both cases produces an insignificant return wave. The same source in a parallel-sided enclosure typical of the majority of loudspeaker cabinets clearly suffers from standing waves caused by multiple reflection. The exterior shape of the boundary is equally important. The sharp edges of the rectangular cabinet behave as secondary sources and produce interference fringes. However, using a curved exterior surface eliminates this problem altogether. The radiated wave is completely free of interference.
The ripple effect of this new discovery will roll outwards to the furthest edges of the audio world. Quite an achievement for a humble garden snail. The outstanding result is Nautilus. redefining the way loudspeakers can look and sound. Its long coiled duct sweeps rear radiation away to infinity, its coned head smoothing the wave path as it leaves the dome. Top drivers, freed of internal cavities, have beaten the age-old problem of sound reflection. The long, tapered antennae of Nautilus, the transmission lines, funnel the rear radiation away without allowing it to interfere with anything else. Four drivers, each devoted to its own passband, require the use of an active crossover with four separate amplifiers to completely avoid the usual cross-talk between reactive components and drivers. The drivers have been decoupled from the cabinet walls to suppress internal resonance. The 12-inch bass driver has been designed from first principles to achieve new levels of accuracy down to 13 hertz. Exponential line loading dimensions have been carefully calculated to produce a highly damped second order characteristic with no ringing at the roll-off frequency and no compromise whatever in bass extension. Nautilus may be the most exciting loudspeaker development of the 90s. Time will tell. Certainly, the removal of all discontinuities combined with exponential line damping is a major step towards achieving everyone's dream of a completely transparent sound. The achievement owes much to painstaking research with just a touch of genius, a little like John Bowers himself. But at B&W, we never have to look far for inspiration.